Boom. This is our midday life. Listen up. This is our midday life with a very important message. Listen up. Consider this a wake-up call. As is written in the description of this video, many of you, many of us, have actually been taught and programmed, brainwashed by denominational Christianity. Many of us have been brainwashed by denominational Christianity to actually approach the promises of God in a mindset that is outrightly wrong. If you are a believer, you have been taught to treat your whole idea of what it is to walk in Christ and the promises of God, you've been taught to look at it outrightly wrong. Outrightly wrong. Now, for those of you who know me, and for those of you who know this institute, know this community, you know there are very few things that I come out and actually say that is outrightly wrong. Probably some of you probably hear me say that for the first time. It's outrightly wrong. Because when it comes to people's perspectives, their opinions concerning whatever they believe, everybody has a self-existent right to their self-determination. But when it comes to your covenant, there is no opinion concerning your covenant. That covenant is very strict. The covenant is rightly stated. If you get the covenant wrong, you die. If you spend time and understand what your covenant is saying, then you walk in the power of life. This is very simple. So there is no middle ground. There is no room for interpretation for your covenant. There is no, I feel that the covenant says this, or I believe that the covenant says this. There is no room for your opinions concerning what this covenant says. If you do not understand the contract, if you do not watch the contract and take the contract for what it says, for what it is, you are going to die. It's that simple. You are not going to be able to do anything. You will live powerlessly and you will die. And that is something in particular that I will not take upon my head for anyone. So hear this out. This is your wake-up call. Your covenant is very simple. Your covenant is that Christ is in you. Well, let me see what the covenant is first, and then we will unpack that. I try to do this as briefly as possible, so that this is no long talk. Straight to the point. Your covenant is to take on Jesus' name as your own. Your covenant always has a covenantal identity, and it has responsibilities. I've said that again, right? Your covenant has a covenantal responsibility and a covenantal identity. Like all contracts, right? You come into the contract, you have a covenantal identity, and you have a contractual responsibility. The other party that you have the contract with, they have a covenantal, a contractual identity, and they also have contractual responsibilities. I don't care who tells you what. I'm putting this out in the atmosphere, and this message is endorsed by Zane Pierre, by founder of the International Institute of Pneumatology. I don't care who tells you what. That contract is immovable. It does not move. And you could sit down there and take, and any one of us could sit down there and take that contract and take it and switch it and remove it from its intended purpose and switch it into a mental disposition, or approach it and or convince others that this covenant in particular is from this particular heart posture or mental disposition. And if you change the contract, and the person believes what you say, they will die too. Because this is like a law of gravity. Gravity does not respect anybody. If you walk off the top of the building and you don't understand that the law of gravity says that if you walk off the top of the building, it will pull you to the ground quickly, then you'll walk off the top of the building and die. It's really simple. Divine covenants is the same thing. What Samson? The spirit, or the contract did not respect Samson. Samson had to respect the contract. And if he wasn't clear about what his contract says, he has nothing. And just like the law of gravity, that says if you walk off the building, you're going to fall to the ground. Natural law. You could be who? You could be the president of the biggest nation on the earth. You walk off the top of that building, the law of gravity does not respect you. You have to respect it. And in the same way, Samson had a contract. The contract didn't respect Samson. The spirit did not respect Samson. You respect the spirit. You respect the contract. And the contract was, don't cut your hair. You cut your hair, you die. It's that simple. So listen up. What is your contract? Your contract has a covenanted identity. That is to take on Jesus' name as your own. You know, why that's your covenanted identity? Because Christ is in you. Through the lens of the garden, you are only breath and body. I want to say that again. Through the lens of the Garden of Eden, you are only breath and body. So if Christ is in you, then Christ is the spirit. And when Paul says you, he's talking about your body. Because that is where they're speaking from. Garden. Christ is in you. Breath. That's Christ. That's Christ. And the body. Christ is in you. It's Christ in the body. Christ is the head of the body. Christ is the breath, the spirit of the body. That's point one. This is no rocket science. No. Point number two. You actually have a contractor responsibility. And the contractor responsibility that you have is to make the promises of God your new lens, your new life priority. Let me explain something to you. That those two things are so simple that they've been taken apart and tried to be made complex. They've been so simple that they've been taken apart and they've been made complex. You have been taught to view the promises of God. First of all, you've been taught to treat Christ in you as something abstract. Like he's somewhere inside it. That my name is John and he's somewhere inside here. No, sir. If you watch the garden, you'd even watch how the temple in Jerusalem was structured, the tabernacle. It's like, when I say structured, I'm talking about the Holy of Holies, the inner court, the outer court. These things reveal how you function. How the temple was structured reveal how you function. And it's very simple. You have a spirit in the body. And you have the ability to form a mental picture as to what you are. I'm going to say that again. You have a spirit in the body. And you have the ability to form a mental picture of what you are. And you have one of two choices to form this mental picture. Either you study the spirit in your body to form the mental picture of what you are, or you use something outside of yourself, some ideal person, thing, to form this mental picture as to what you are. If you use something external, then the spirit is your life source. If you use something external, then you abandon your life source. You will die. If you use the spirit inside of you, then you're using your life source. You will live. It's that simple. When it comes to the promises, this is the one that I head into in particular. We have been brainwashed. Now, I am saying this with tens of thousands of hours of research and experiment. And everything that we have been taught in westernized, denominational, let's just say denominational Christianity, is a lie. It is not may not have been intentionally a lie, but it does not work. What you've been taught, the general idea between what we've been taught in mainstream Christianity and denominational Christianity, is that you are powerless and you are depending on God outside of you to give you something, and so you are waiting to receive. You have been given a mental picture of God out in the sky, and you're praying to him and you're waiting for him to give it to you. There is no contract in the Bible that functions like that. Do you know that? That is wholly a westernized construct. It's wholly a construct that we have in our denominational Christianity. That I am, through this video, giving you a big wake-up call on. Because the contract does not respect you. You must respect the contract. So listen to this. You've been taught to be a receiver. I want to say that again. You have been taught that you are the receiver. And whatever your mental picture is concerning Christ or God, you are using that mental picture and you are there. You are standing there like a powerless insect, like a powerless animal, waiting for this person to give this to you. Your contract makes you a priest. A priest in the Old Testament is someone who is the flesh of God himself, taking on the name and speaking as God himself. You didn't hear me. You not listen to what I'm saying. A priest is not someone who serves a God outside of himself. A priest is someone who is the body of God himself. Which is why Paul says, Christ is in you. That means that your new covenant has given you the covenantal identity of Christ, because your covenant takes its identity from the spirit that has been placed in your body. So, naturally, the whole idea in our westernized culture that says you cannot call yourself Yeshua or call yourself God, stay there, you die. Watch me. I know that there are many people who still hold on to these concepts, and in no form or fashion do I mean to be insensitive to your perspectives and to your opinions. But I am saying this not because I'm reading it in the Bible. I'm saying this because these are things that we have put to test through lots of experiments, thousands of experiments in the last 7 years. And if you do not take on Jesus' name as your own and function as the man himself, because of this, his spirit that he put inside this body, you are not going to see any manifestation. And I don't care how much you call out to God, you do not change the contract. You respect the contract. The contract does not respect you. So you are going to have to make a decision. Sometimes I feel like we are pussyfooting around these dynamics. What the contract actually says, what the contract actually is how the contract is structured. And we have the liberty within our westernized Christian community. We have the liberty, or we have assumed the liberty, to give opinions concerning something that is designed to give you life or leave you to die. And we spend so much time in our westernized culture putting opinions to these things. And the persons who you're sharing this opinion to could take you seriously. Believe what you say, because there is no reference point for these things in our westernized Christian culture. We are living by tradition and not by covenant. We are living by traditions and not by covenant. And so we pussyfooting around these things. Everybody have an opinion. But guess what? Everybody who have an opinion concerning the contract, they sick. They have mental health issues. If that is not a sign that the understanding of the contract is skewed, I don't know what else is. Think about it. For God's sake. So your contract is take on the identity. That is your covenanted identity. You're supposed to be praying through that covenant. You're supposed to be speaking to creation through that covenant. You're supposed to be thinking through that identity, that covenanted identity. Your system of logic is supposed to be through that covenanted identity. The way you see things, the way you analyze things and process things is supposed to be through that covenanted identity. That is your covenant. Thousands of years have passed with a nation, a whole nation, being given this covenant. It comes into the westernized Christian world, and we stand up in our denominational Christian world and take it and start to philosophize this and philosophize that. Now, I'm not saying that people do it maliciously, but what I'm saying is we need to wake the heck up, because the covenant works. The covenant works. Thousands of hours have gone into this. The covenant works. You do not change the covenant. The covenant does not respect you. You respect the covenant. So if it gives you a covenantal identity, for God's sake, put on all of your perspectives and walk the covenantal identity. We have seen hundreds by now of healings. Move creation. Stop storms. Move animals. Communicate to animals. Change weather when we desire. All kind of different things going on our side here. Interfacing with God even through that covenantal identity. It works. And anybody who is actually stopping and actually trying to diminish what the covenantal identity is either you're ignorant or you're arrogant. None of them are good. When it comes to God's promises, the next thing that we've been taught, the covenantal identity. When it comes to God's promises, you have been brainwashed. Brainwashed. We had been brainwashed to think that the promises of God is something that you receive from God. I'm certain everybody who is seeing this and will see this can attest to the fact that you've been taught that God is faithful to his word. But the faithfulness that you're talking about is not what the Bible is talking about. And I'm saying this also with thousands of hours of application. And if you're putting opinions to these things and you change the contract will respect you. It didn't work for Samson, right? It didn't work for Saul, King Saul. Starboy changed the contract. And there was no spirit. Samson do the same thing. Hey, no spirit. Because the contract is like a law. It's like a natural law of physics. Physics don't respect you. You respect the physics. Unless you're walking in this contract and then you can actually bend the natural laws of physics, or actually not bend it, because you can't bend it. You walk above it because you are a superseding law. So the promises of God, you have been taught to view wrongly. You've been taught that you have to sit down there and receive. And your reception is from the perspective that somewhere God outside of you is going to give you this. How much people are you praying for like that? That you see still sick, and some of them end up dying. You don't do this. We're doing the same thing over and over, expecting different results. All because you want to exercise the liberty to put opinions to a contract that does not respect you. That contract has been put there by your father, by your spiritual father. You are not more powerful than the contract. As a matter of fact, the contract is not even something that is like a condition. If you look, if you watch the contract is actually designed to keep you in your own spirit. So why the heck you think you have opinions? You could put opinions on a contract. This is a covenant. So the promises of God have been given to you and you're looking at it as something that you receive. No, your covenant makes you a priest. A priest in the Bible is the flesh of God himself. The priest is the flesh of God himself. A priest is the Adam in the garden. The visible representation of the invisible God. The visible representation of the invisible breath. Christ in you. Priest of Christ Yeshua. Priest of Elohim. That means that your covenant is not something that your promises of God in the covenant is not something that you receive. The promises of God is something, let me put it like this. The promises of God is the standard of your lifestyle. It's the bar that you're supposed to be living by. It's the standard that has been put there for you to live from. Not something that, because you're treating, most of us have been taught to treat the promises of God as something that you're hoping that God has mercy upon you and he gives it to you. It's a lie. It's a destructive lie. And you need to wake up. The promises of God are your responsibilities. Listen to what I'm telling you. Paul says, renew your mind. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Oh, Lord Jesus. Hey, I wish I could get this a point across in a way that it just jolts you with some lightning into your body. That we let go these perspectives of saying, praying and asking God and saying, I trust you, God, because you're watching them outside of you. When you are the physical revelation of Elohim, which means when you come into the covenant, you do not wait on God to do something. You have been made God with God by the covenant. That means the promises of God is not God's promises, is now your word too. And therefore, you're supposed to treat it as your word. Show God's integrity by you being God, fulfilling your word. The promises of God is the bar that has been set for you. It's not something you beg God for. It's something that is a bar. You hold yourself responsible to that bar. Your healing. Some of you searching for healing and pursuing healing and you're not seeing the healing. Why? Because you're using the same dynamic that is victim-like. You're waiting to receive. The promises of God has made you Elohim. Elohim means authority. That means that if you're an authority, you do not receive anything. An authority has full responsibility to make it happen. Which means, if the promises of God is the bar that has been set for you, anything between the bar and you do not have to talk to God about. Because if God set that as the bar, then anything that comes between you and God, when I said you and God here, anything that comes between you and what God says you're supposed to be, healed, whole, peace, anything that stands between you and what that says, you have 100% justification to annihilate it. And the Spirit of God will empower you to do so. Because anything that stands between you and what that promise says is anti-God. Therefore, it is the enemy of God, and it is you as the priest to take action to bring it about. Listen to me. All of this victim-like living, we need to shake ourselves out of it. Because believe it or not, it's the hinge between whether you live long or you die. All of these, and I am fully, as I said, for some of you, it's the first time you're actually hearing me say that this is outrightly wrong. Because I don't do that. Everybody here is self-existent, and everybody has the right to their self-determination. But when it comes to covenant in the Bible, there is no room for interpretation. Covenants are very straight. If you do not change the covenant and expect the results of the covenant. You do not adjust the covenant because of your opinions and then reap the benefits of the covenant. Covenants in the Bible are like laws of physics. Gravity does not respect you. You respect gravity. If you walk off the top of the building, I've seen it over and over. If you walk off the top of the building, you're going to fall to your death. And in the same way, covenants in the Bible are the same. Samson is an example. I use him earlier on again, reiterating this. Samson had a covenant. The covenant did not respect Samson. Samson respects the covenant. If the covenant say, don't cut your hair, don't cut your hair. If you cut your hair, you have no spirit. King Saul, again, bringing him back. The covenant say, this is the covenant to walk towards king. You abandon the covenant, you have no spirit. You respect the covenant. The covenant does not respect you. And all of these westernized, all of these assumptions of authority to give interpretations to covenant is outrightly wrong. Because those who actually take up that interpretation of your covenant and die, that spada is on your head. You don't play with that. Everybody can have opinions, but covenants are very straight. So just to reiterate, you have two contexts of your covenant. And we need in the westernized Christian community, we need to, in denomination, in this Christian community of this generation, to stop the pussyfooting around things and perspectives and people and what people think about if I say I am Yeshua, I am God, what people think about that. Watch me. Listen to me. The very said people that actually contradicting the covenant, they are sick. They have mental health issues. They're struggling. And so if they're not bearing the fruit of their doctrine, why do you care? The covenant, all covenants in the Bible have two components. Eh? Covenantal identity, covenantal responsibility. And of course, in your covenant, in the new covenant, of course, it comes with also the third component is anointing. We're not talking about that here today. We're talking about your covenantal responsibilities. Is the identity and your responsibility. And your covenantal identity is Jesus Christ. Is Elohim. It makes you priest. A priest, I say that again, reiteration. The priest in the Old Testament is the body of God. Because the priesthood takes its template from the Garden of Eden. Just as breath of God, the man in the garden, the man was a priest in the garden. And therefore, all priests are seen in the Old Testament as the body of God. It's no different in the new. So if your covenant makes you priests, you are the body of God. That's the breath of Jesus. Therefore, if you're functioning in the covenant you have to function in your covenantal identity. And we need to stop pussyfooting around that. You are Elohim with Elohim. Spend time understanding the covenant, because the covenant is life-giving. Interpretations will only result in your death. And secondly, your responsibility in the covenant. What Paul calls mind renewal in the Old Testament is called circumcision of the mind. That physical circumcision was a physical act that was actually used to refer to your commitment to circumcise your mind from everything else and make what that contract says your universe. And in the new covenant, that's the promises of God. That's what your mind is supposed to be programmed to. But again, in my synopsis here, you have been taught the promises of God from the perspective of a victim, that you want to receive it from this person out in the sky. Your covenant, the promises of God in the Bible, is your covenantal responsibility. Therefore, that is the bar, the standard that you're supposed to be living by, to hold yourself responsible to. Therefore, healing is not something that you receive. Healing is your responsibility to manifest. And therefore, if the covenant has made you Elohim, you must treat God's promises not as God's word out in the sky or somewhere outside of you. God's word has now become your word. And you have been given the empowerment to bring it about. It is the bar. It is not something that you receive. Take a look around. We are in the Christian community, we're doing the same things over and over and expecting a different result. We have now tens of thousands of hours under our belt with research and experiment. And I am telling you, I am not asking you. You have the right to an opinion, but your opinion could lead to your death. Your covenant has a covenantal identity. With tens of thousands of hours of research, thousands of experiments, I am not asking you, I'm telling you. If you do not take up your covenantal identity, you are not going to be functioning in anything. You'll just be a philosopher and a theologian. And we have many of that in this Christian community. Your covenantal identity is that. Which means you have to start treating your body, soul, your words, thoughts, and deeds as the words, thoughts, and deeds of Jesus. Of course, once it is in alignment with your covenantal, with the promises. And your promises in particular are not things that you receive. Some of you sitting down there wanting healing, wanting finance, want your relationships to be fixed. And you stand up there and you're asking God to give you these things. Big boy, that is not your covenant. Your covenant is, you've been made priest. These are your responsibilities. This is the bar. Therefore, you are required in the person, in the persona, in the identity of God himself to bring it into manifestation, to take action. Take action. It's your responsibility to bring it into being. So if you're looking for healing, looking for finances, you want your relationships to be better, it requires, if you are Elohim, if you've made Elohim, you're coming to Christ and Christ is in you, that is Elohim in you, that is authority in you. And authority does not wait to receive. Authority is given the full responsibility to make it happen. Responsibility is make it happen. Make it happen. That means you in Christ are exalted. Go to Psalm 118. You in Christ are exalted. And in Psalm 118 it says, it actually says that if you are exalted, then you are valiant. And if you are exalted, then everything has been given to you and you are valiant. That means that you have to get up, be courageous, and be determined. It is the bar that has been set for you to live from. It's the standard. With how many hundreds of healings that I have seen in this process, I'm telling you, everything you've been taught in denominational Christianity from the perspective of being a receiver, you will die. All of the research proves that this is something that you take on as your own and you execute. You have full responsibility. Behold, I give you power. Get off your butts and start to function. Take on the responsibilities that you're given and bring it into manifestation. No more victim, no more receiver mode. You've been put into God mode. And therefore, you watch what the standard, watch what the standard says. And as Jesus himself, you take action to make sure that standard is met. Healing is not something God gives you or blesses you with. It's your responsibility. It's your standard of living. Think about it. Because if you don't, you will not even be able to help others. This is not opinion. Do not allow opinions and doctrinal foolishness to get involved in contracts. All right. Blessings and much love.